Good morning. I'd like to welcome everybody as we're gathered together this morning, as we worship, as we praise, as we grow in faith, as we grow in love toward one another. We have a few announcements this morning. First of all, added into our prayers, we have Katie Henry at the top of our prayer area. And just to kind of give you an idea of what, why we moved her up there, because Katie Henry and Symphony of the Nations sharing music outreach to Middle Eastern refugees in Athens. And the next week, then they're moving on to seven cities in Germany, and we're praying for safety, health, and provision. So suffice to say, Katie and the group that is going around doing their music ministry are doing it among Middle Eastern refugees in the Athens area throughout this last week and some of this coming week. And then they're going to go off to seven different cities during the same type of ministry in Germany. So a really blessed ministry that she's going about. But also we're going to pray for her safety and pray for the Lord to watch over the work that she's going to be doing in these next weeks coming up here. So definitely be keeping Katie Henry in your prayers this next week. Let's see, I got about several papers this morning. Also, as I've said the last couple of weeks, we're in a position of looking for a part-time youth minister to work in our youth ministry position here. If you know of anybody, just direct them in my direction. Also, as I mentioned before, we're getting up here very quickly. Got about maybe 6 weeks or so before our before and after care program is going to be up and started. If you'd like to be a part of that, we have some on the table just outside the main office. We have some envelopes, and we also have a listing of some of the needs that we have for things for our before and after care program. So if you would like to go and get something for the before and after care program, we have the list right out there, just outside the main office. If instead you'd like to donate financially in order to help to purchase the supplies that are needed, we got the envelopes that are available right out there too. Nice and bright colors, by the way. And the last announcement that we have this morning, yesterday we had our first distribution, food distribution of the season. And that went really very, very well as we went forward. I think the numbers are behind me. Yep, there we go. As I just kind of looked there, we had we hit 100 households that we were able to help and serve during this food distribution that we had yesterday. 67 of those households were here at Berea. We also then got connected with a apartment complex over in Edina. It's mostly senior living. And the rest of it is for those that are handicapped. And so we also went over and helped to serve about 33 households in those single unit apartments just about a mile away here from Berea as well. And you can see some of the rest of the statistics there. 81 people were 17 and under, 121 adults. Yes, seniors are adults, I know, but it'll still count a different way. And we had 62 seniors that we were able to serve as well. 19 people at one point or another came and volunteered, and that was a wonderful blessing as we go forward. It was over 3,000 pounds. As you go out this morning, all that we have left is we have some pears. That's the remnants of about 950 pounds of pears. That's a lot of pears, in case you were wondering. And we got a little bit left over of the lettuce, and that's what's left over of not quite 500 pounds of lettuce. Again, 500 pounds of lettuce is a lot of lettuce. If you want to see what that looks like, about 2 weeks, is it 2 weeks, Ken?
Yeah.
2 weeks from yesterday, we're going to be having our second food distribution as well. So if you want to see what something like 950 pounds of pears looks like, show up at the beginning when they show up with the whole pallet of food as we gather together. Thank you. Yes, it is my birthday. 45 years, so thank you very much.
cards.
All that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ our Lord,
who lives with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
You may be seated. We've seen the last two verses of our opening. Seed being the word of God. And we know that parable very, very, very well. But here in Isaiah, 700 years before Jesus gave that parable, we see pretty much the basic idea and concepts of that parable put forward here by the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah proclaimed, "For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, making it to bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So my word be that goes out from my mouth, and shall not return to me empty, but shall accomplish that which I propose, and shall succeed in the things for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy, and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall make a name for the Lord, an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As we go on our epistle text, continuing through the book of Romans, we come to Romans, the 8th chapter. And as we come towards the end of this reading, we're called upon that we are heirs of God, meaning all that God has to give is there and given for us. St. Paul writes, "So then, brothers, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the things of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption and as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him, in order that we may also be glorified with him." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is found according to St. Matthew, the 13th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As I mentioned before, this is the parable of the sower, the sowing of the seed, the sowing of God's word. And the first section is the parable. And then the second section is Jesus explaining what that parable means. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it, while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on the rocky places, where it did not have much soil, and sprang up quickly, because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came out, the plants were scorched, and they withered, because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop 100-fold, 60, or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let them hear. Listen to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the seed sown along the path. The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. But the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces a crop, yielding 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated as we sing our sermon. Son. You might add in there Holy Week and all the things that happen and take place during Holy Week. But of all the teachings that Jesus gives us, as he sits down with the crowd, we hear the parable of the seed, we hear the parable of the weeds, weeds is next to me. We come to the parable of the great treasure, the parable of the pearl. And we have all these parables of teachings of our Lord. Out of all these parables, that sower of the seed is one that oftentimes sticks the most right into our hands. We remember it. We hear it. And Jesus gave us these parables because a lot of times it's easy to remember what's going on in a parable than it is to remember Jesus just telling us the way that it is. It was that way in his day. It's that way for us now. And we hear that whole image of the sower. the one going out and sowing the seed, sowing God's word wherever he's at. And we start to ask, you know, some of those questions about what's going on here. Why did Jesus choose to have a sower as opposed to maybe some modern ways of planting as we go forward? Because the whole point of this parable gets down to that seed. Gets down to what is that seed. And the seed that's being sown out by the sower is the word of God. It is what God has to give to us. And if we look at all of what God has to give to us, that is one of the most precious things. Because when we hear that word, that creates faith in our hearts. When we hear that word, it gives to us peace, comfort, and joy. When we hear that word, we grow in faith. We feel stronger where our Lord has placed us. When we hear that word, God brings us closer as brothers and sisters in Christ. We might think a long time back when that word was spoken over us, when we had the water, and we were brought to the water, and we were baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And with that word, God came to us, put that seed within us, and said, "You are my own." You think of all these incredible gifts. This is one of the most precious, beautiful, incredible things that God has given to us. And we've heard that again and again and again, haven't we? And how incredible God's word is. And the fact that we spend a good chunk of our time reading God's word, Old Testament, Epistle, Gospel, shows just how central and key that is. Now when it comes to the readings, and we come to the sermon, does everybody stand up for the reading of the Gospel or for the pastor preaching? We all stand up for the reading of the Gospel, right? Because that's an incredible word. That's the word pointing what Jesus said, what Jesus did, what he accomplished on our behalf. We stand up for the Gospel because of how precious and incredible that word is. So knowing how precious that is, why did Jesus use the parable of the sower? Well, you can always throw out the easy answer, right? Well, that's how he did it that day. Okay, there's an easy answer. There's only kind of a little bit more when you think about what's going on and what's taking place. Because that wasn't the only way that they sowed or that they made plants. When they were going to go out and they were going to make an olive tree, they didn't go out and start throwing olive seeds all over the place and see what happens. They were careful. They put the olive seed, they grew it, they took care of it, they watched over that thing, and they helped make sure that it grew up into a beautiful olive plant. When they were making a vineyard, they didn't just go out to the vineyard and start willy-nilly throwing seed all over the place and say, "I hope some grapes show up somewhere." They planted them in rows. They put them very carefully where they were at. I was once visiting a farmer, and he was showing me his farm implements. And as they were built, as he had a corn crop, and as he was putting everything together, he showed me how they planted. First, you had to have the field all ready, of course. But then you have this incredible machine coming behind the tractor. And as he drove along the rows, it would go along, and you'd have this one part come in, make the nice little hole. Then the next part would come in, drop the nice little seed. Then the next part would come along and a little of fertilizer right there into the seed. And then the next part would come along and make sure that it was completely covered. Every one of those seeds was really cared for, watched over, and planted intimately and carefully. But that's not the way of the sower, is it? The sower, as you can kind of see there, you have the little, you held out there, you have the seed here, and you cast the seed all over the place. You were casting the seed just to broaden it all the way out. And you knew it wasn't all going to be in the right place. They knew some of it would go and be eaten by the birds. They knew that some of it was going to go off and was going to be taken away. They knew some would fall in the weeds. They knew some would fall in the path. They knew some would be in bad soil. But they knew that plenty of it would fall on that good soil. And as the word of God was cast out and brought forward, that it would grow 30, 60, 100 fold from what was anticipated and what was expected, maybe just one little seed. Why didn't they take care of it? Because Jesus is using this parable very intently. Remember, we start with how incredible and beautiful that word of God is. As the pastor comes into the pulpit, he doesn't just go up and willy-nilly start throwing the word out. He takes the time, the care, put the sermon together. What should I preach this week? What should I share with everybody this week? What does the word of God point us towards right here, right now, as his holy people? And God's pointing out to us another thing right here. He's telling us that we're not the best farmers. He's telling us that we don't know all of the soil that's out there. And so as his church, we are called upon take that incredible word and scatter it wherever it might be. The modern day farmers, they know where that soil is. A lot of modern day farmers have their entire area, all of their fields plotted, planted, and set up on their computer. And then over a couple of years, they know exactly where the best of the harvest is going to come from and where it's not going to come. They know the low areas where the water's going to come on and there'll be a bare patch. They know the area that's really good stuff. And this 1 acre over here is going to produce more than those three over there. Modern day farmers and farmers men of all time know their soil. They know what's going to happen, what's going to take place, where to have it sprayed, where to have it brought forward. But we're not as good a farmers. We can, as God's church, look out and say, I know the good soil. And oftentimes we make mistakes when we look at that. That's where he talks about where that seed is brought forward. Some of that seed, some of that word, some of that most incredible stuff that God has given to us falls on the path. And that word is just put out there onto a hard heart. And the devil, before anything can take place, comes, takes it, and brings it away. And that's sometimes very sad. And as a church, that can be rather frustrating, can't it? When you're taking this thing God has given to us, this word of God, that we gather together every Sunday to read, to sing, to hear, to grow. And we want everybody to hear it. We want all people to know God's good and gracious will. And that's his will. What is God's will? What is God's desire? God's will is that all people hear and all people be saved. That's God's will. Then you get our will thrown in there and it messes the whole thing up. But God's will, his desire, is that all people might be saved. And boy, is it frustrating when this incredible thing that's been given to us is thrown out there and seemingly does nothing. You have a friend, and you start talking to that friend, and you start hearing about what's going on, and you think this person is going to hear the word of the Lord, and they will believe. You know, I have a good friend in college, and they're out helping people. They're out watching out for other people. They're loving their neighbor. They're showing God some of the things in the world that rightly ought to be done. And you think, they're doing this already. This is good soil. Put the word here, it's going to grow, right? I can remember talking with Charles as I was in college, saying, this has got to be good soil.
as I shared my faith,
as I shared what God had done for me, his heart to the faith was as hard as it could be. He was in that first category. I thought perfect soil. And I was wrong. Sometimes that soil falls onto that second one. Areas with some soil, but really shallow. Where it starts to grow up and blossom, and say, this is going to be incredible. And then it withers and dies. When I was in Wichita Falls, Texas, there was a young man, John. One Sunday morning, he just came to worship. He came into worship one Sunday morning, went over and sat next to Pat Patricio. Pat, one of the elders of the congregation, one of those men who kind of went out and did every position in the church. And he was now about 80 years old at that point. But this young man kind of took a shine to him, sat down next to him. And over the course of the next 2 months, it was some incredible things to see. You could just see his faith start to grow, his faith start to blossom. As he started coming to Bible study, he was there every single Sunday. He was saying, how can I learn more? He said, let's look forward and let's plan in order to have an adult class so we can get this all together. He said, I'd love to come forward and receive communion. So let's make this all happen. And you can see his faith just growing and sprouting and going. And this has been on for almost 2.5 months. And boy, did it bring a smile onto my face. And then, I didn't see him again. Talking with a couple of people that knew what was going on around him, he had gotten connected with some of the gangs. And that incredible faith that he could see growing, sprouting, and going was really shallow. And that face withered. Sometimes that word of the Lord, that incredible gift that's been given to us, is placed among the thorns. And Christ puts it in this way. That word that's placed upon the thorns, when the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. When our eyes, instead of looking up continuously to our Lord, end up looking at what's going on in my life, end up looking upon wealth, instead of looking at God, looking down here upon myself, as I sometimes say, navel gazing, where you're taking all your time looking at your belly button down here, now looking at yourself, instead of keeping your eyes up to the Lord. There was a young man who, when he first came into the faith, was just out of college, just learning, and he heard about tithing. And so he said, you know what? I'm going to go forward. Of all that the Lord gives me, I will give 10% back to him first, before anything else. And as time went along, he got a better job, finally became one of the top people in his organization, and he was making some pretty good money. So he came to the pastor and he said, you know, pastor, when I first came and started tithing, it was 10%, but it really wasn't that much. But now, it's a lot of money, pastor. I don't know if I can keep on doing this. So the pastor said, okay, let's sit down and pray. And in that prayer he said, Lord, we come before you and pray that you will be with this young man. Bring him to a place where you are first in his life. Those thorns, those weeds were starting to choke his faith. Sometimes we are incredibly blessed as we get to throw that seed out. And we don't know where that's going to go. But it goes on the good soil. You get to see it grow. And you get to see it grow. And as any farmer will say, one of the happiest points of the time is when the harvest finally comes on. Get to see that smile as they work all night, all into the dark, in order to bring in that harvest when it is ripe and when it is ready. There was a young man. He had a very, very tough job. His job was being an executioner here in the United States. That was his profession. So whenever the time would come and somebody was on death row, it was his job to make sure everything was done, to administer the drugs for that person, and to commit the execution, to be the actual one doing it. You think of somebody that that's their profession. That sounds like hard soil, doesn't it? But guess what? That was very good soil. That young man eventually started to hear the word of the Lord, came to faith, and that young man is now a pastor in the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. He's even written a book that you can buy from Concordia Publishing House about how the Lord brought him and cared for him. And he was good soil, and that good soil produces 30, 60, and 100-fold. So when you look at this parable of the sower, of that incredible word being tossed around, Jesus could have said any way to do it. He could have said, be very careful about every single seed. But that's not what he said. He said, with that word that God has given to us, throw that seed everywhere. We're not good enough farmers to look at someone and know if they're bad soil or good soil or what will happen. That's God's prerogative. God says we as his church, in whatever way can be done, are to take that word, send it out, and put it wherever it will be. And his word and the words of Isaiah will not return empty. His word will do the purpose for which he so desires. Now may the peace that passes all understanding keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Now we confess that word, we confess that faith, as we please rise to the words of the Nicene Creed. We confess.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten as Lord before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both living and dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray, Lord, may you watch over all of those who share your word. Be with all of those who scatter your word. Be with all of those here at Berea. We let others know this incredible gift that you have given to us. Be with those far away who share that same word. Be with Chris, Josh, and Bruce and their family. And especially, Lord, lift up Katie to your hands. And we ask that you will watch over her. Keep her safe. She goes about this work you have set before her. And may her words, may her actions scatter that seed. May it go to good soil and might be abundantly fruitful. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray, O Lord, that you would watch over all of those in this fellowship who are sick and who are hurting. Especially lift up Bob, Thomas, Sydney, Betty, Hickia, Richard, James, Marv, Vern, Peggy, Elaine, Shelley, Herman, Mark, Agnes, Nora, Lavis, Lou, and Phyllis. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We ask, O Lord, you'll be with all of those who have lost loved ones. Grant them, Lord, your peace. Direct their eyes up to you and the salvation that can come only through you. We lift up, Lord, the family of Carolyn Green, sister of Ruth Cordes, and ask, Lord, that you will bless that family. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We ask, O Lord, that you would watch over all of our friends and our families, those who do not know you. We ask that you will work through the sowers to cast that word. And we ask, Lord, that in them, that those loved ones in our lives might be good soil. And help us, Lord, to see that, because that seed go into a crop 30, 60, and 100-fold. For those that are sick and hurting in our lives, we lift up into your hands Paul, Stephanie, Jean, John, Dick, Chelsea, Kathy, Dick, Joan, Jackie, Art, and Lorraine. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We ask, O Lord, to be with our military personnel stationed throughout this world. Watch over them in their duty and bring them safely home. We ask the Lord that the leaders throughout this world aim their eyes towards peace. We especially pray for our elected leaders. You might grant to them a servant's heart. Grant to them your wisdom. And give them the strength to follow you. Especially we lift up our president and vice president, our Congress and Supreme Court, our governor, our legislature, and all of our elected leaders. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We thank you, O Lord, for the ministry that you gave to us yesterday of our food distribution. For all of those, Lord, who are touched by our volunteers, we ask that you will watch over them where the seed might be planted. Help it to grow, Heavenly Father. And we pray, Lord, that you will bless all of those who served yesterday. Guide them, lead them, and let them know of the work they have done in your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And finally, for these and all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And we pray the word the Lord taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he gave thanks, he gave them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same manner also took the cup after supper. When he gave thanks, he gave them and said, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the remission of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord all of us.
And also with you.
Maybe so.
Thank you.
everlasting. Depart in peace.
Amen.
We pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God. You have refreshed us with salutary gift and implore you of your mercy. Strengthen us in faith, courage, and love toward one another. Your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and grant you peace. Amen. Say together our closing hymn.